I always love your game. I was just talking about it with some guys too. Like, you play the game. I've told you this before. In our heads, if like if we all could hoop how we want it, we'd play like you. But you do it in the NBA against against Jason Tatum in Boston. Like, you do it like, you know. Yeah. So I love that, and I love that debate. But I think, I mean, you're up there for me as well. I don't even know who else. I feel like Mike doesn't get enough talk in these convos. He's obviously incredibly skilled. I think there's a little bit of, there's probably some role player types who are like incredibly skilled. They have to be to even be in the league.
For sure.
But I think what you do, it's just, it's a beautiful game. Like every, no, true like hoopers appreciate that.
Thank you.
So
and Uncle Drew is me. You know, I am Uncle Drew. So a lot of the embodiment of that spirit of what I was relaying from Uncle Drew of just practicing the fundamentals and, you know, you don't get old because you stop playing. You stop playing because you get old, or however that my axiom goes with Uncle Drew, because you can flip it either which way. It's about the love. And when I'm out there and I'm playing, I attribute my curiosity to learning more about what I do to other great people in the world. You know, and them finding a meditative, calming state when they're doing something that they're passionate about. And we have so many interruptions and distractions that go on. So, you know, there's always someone that's trying to throw you off that balance, you know, and that grounding space that you're in. So when you're working on your craft and no one's there, that's probably one of the most peaceful places for me. But also being in the zone while you're performing in front of people is also a meditative, peaceful state. But I don't want to carry everyone else's stuff outside of the game onto my normal life, which ends up happening. And I think people forget, like, we're connecting through the energy that is being performed in front of you. Don't forget that. Don't take that for granted. You know what I mean? Because I don't take it for granted. So if you're going to take my talent for granted and then try to throw stuff on me, it just doesn't really make sense. So I think I'm appreciative that I've been able to appeal to the I don't want to say average human being, but I know that I can blend in. I can blend in a lot easier than Bron.
I think people would be shocked to see you in person, how not small, but normally sized the person you are.
Yeah, in a average height industry of 6'7", you know, being tall, being athletic. Me and my dad started in the backyard, you know, putting the rim together first, and he was teaching me how to put something together first before I just came outside and started hooping on the basket. Mm-hmm. You know, he was really teaching me about the details of understanding the fundamentals, like as I revert back to Uncle Drew, but really enjoying it, you know, like really, really enjoying it. And it doesn't mean that somebody's like putting a carrot in front of you or somebody's whipping you to do it. It's just, I did it myself, and I finally looked my dad in the eyes when I was 17, 18 years old, and he couldn't believe it. And you could ask him, like, once you meet with him or you catch up with him, but he didn't think that I was outside as often
as you were.
He thought I was in the house playing, you know, video games on the computer or on AIM back in the day, or, you know, trying to get my Facebook followers up and my MySpace popping, trying to choose my top 8. But I was outside, man, so I sacrificed a lot of relationships just chasing greatness, you know. And it was already thrust upon me, but I had to chase it to really learn how to express it in a way that it could look beautiful for people to appreciate. So I'm grateful for that.
So I want to ask you a question that JJ, your Duke brethren, asked Kevin.
Yeah, man.
I think it's a great question. And
no dinosaur questions with JJ ever again. or conspiracy talk with JJ. He set me up that damn podcast, man.
Go ahead. He asked Kevin if he felt like he mastered basketball. And I thought it was a fascinating question for you, because I say that all the time on Twitter. I feel like Kai has mastered basketball and gets bored. It's just like, it's the same as me saying, yo, he might just retire, disappear, we'll never see Kyrie again. But I do feel like you're pretty close. Like, you have all of the skills. We still got to see the skyhook, but do you feel like you've mastered basketball?
I feel like I represent the mastery of basketball. So because I represent that, I'm always going to be a student. So You know, you can call me a master, but I myself would probably just call myself a teacher of the game at this point. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I put in enough hours to call myself a master, but I choose not to because I just like remaining a student. You know, I like making mistakes. I like figuring out new things and new ways to motivate myself. I like finding new skills that I think other people see me as great at, but I don't feel that way. Mm-hmm. You know, like sometimes when I go left on my pull-ups, I'm still trying to get my right foot to be pointed to the rim a certain type of way. And that's how intricate my mind works. Yeah. You know, that's how my process, how I process information is totally different. And I've had to understand that sometimes I'm speaking a different language when I'm explaining these things to people. You know, I try to bring them up to speed. I'm like, you know, let me sit with you and try to explain to you like how I'm looking at this thing. But it's that's where I feel like I'm at in the long list of masters who have come before me, right, is still being a student and still learning how to teach in a way where I'm teaching myself and it's therapy and I'm able to act on it. But I get more enjoyment and purpose from seeing others do it. Mm-hmm. You know, me being able to see them grow from 6 months to 12 months to a year to 2 months of them being curious, them being students, and then, oh, I think I got what you're saying now. You know, that it's a different feeling for me now. So I would say, no, I don't feel like I've mastered yet. Do I feel like I am a master? Yes, but I would like to talk about that more as I retire from this and I can just freely express, you know.
Do you feel like you'll stick around, coach, be involved in the game in that way?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I feel like you're one of those guys that could never not have basketball.
I definitely cannot have basketball. I definitely cannot have basketball. You can set it down. Yes, I have chugged basketball enough in red solo cups, metaphorically. You know what I mean? Like, I've done enough. I've taken enough shots at the basketball bar. I've been around enough basketball people, basketball heads, basketball maniacs. I've been around enough basketball fandom, basketball religion. I've consumed enough of it to this point to know, like, if I overconsume it, I go home drunk with emotions that aren't really mine, you know, and I start taking on people's perceptions about what they see that it's not an original thought, you know what I mean? Yeah. When that stuff starts to seep into your regular, I was about to say regular degular, but I was about to, when it starts seeping into the normalcy of your life, that's when, like, I've seen it, you know, like, disease people to the point where they can't really shake whether or not they're living out their basketball fantasy lifestyle, or, you know, with people yelling their name 24/7 and them living up to other people's expectations, or what's really driving them to stay in this thing. Like, yeah. You know, what's driving me is I have my daughter and my son. I have, you know, my development team, you know, that I have, like, which is a small group of locals, but it's also extended out to Instagram and social media, where I bring in a bunch of kids and I'm just dropping gems. And it's not about being physically dominating. It's literally about the mental aspect and the spiritual aspect and keeping the game sacred, mm-hmm. You know, not allowing other people to dictate how they feel about it.
So all right. So off the court, Kyrie does have a life. I love that.
If you didn't get that from my basketball drunkenness.
You're incredibly private, which I really appreciate and respect. But, like, yeah, what is your day-to-day like when you're not at the gym being a master, as you said?
Yeah.
Like, are you're binge-watching these shows? Like, obviously, you're raising two young children. You're doing that.
Yeah.
But, like, what are you listening to these days? Like,
so I'll tell you this. Let me just drop a statistic on you first.
Okay.
It's out of our billion human being world, right? 0.03% of people make it to the NBA. That statistic alone, if you quantify that between, you know, people playing college basketball, people playing high school basketball, there's not a, like, a guideline to when you make it and what your life is like. So the normalcy of the things I speak about, the subjects I speak about, you know, I like to try my best to make it relatable. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But I have a question for you. Do you wake up and have an agent, a manager, corporations, you know, that you represent that are depending on your performance, that, you know, do you have a family dynamic where you're the only person walking in those shoes? You know, no one else can, they can give you advice and support. I'm grateful for it. But can they ever truly understand the shoes that you're walking in?
You have an incredibly unique experience, for sure. I'll say during the series, talking with Kevin a lot, and that was kind of one of my things. It's like, yo, we were, I don't remember what we were doing. We might have been going to the game, and it was just so much convo about him that I'm noticing, and I know he's noticing, and it was just surreal just how constant that is. And I go, this has to feel crazy, right? But he's so used to it. He's obviously a pro. He's been doing this 15 years.
Yeah.
But there are times, like, when we talking as close as we are, it's like, I got advice, but I'm not doing the stuff you're doing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, I got ideas.
Yeah.
But you know better than me.
Yeah.
So to answer your question, nah. Some of that responsibility, but no.
That's honest. I don't know how many people are going to be honest with that. They're going to be like, try their best to understand it and you know what I mean? Like, make
you,
sense
You had me
it.
For a second. I'm like, agent, oh, okay. Corporation, family, yeah. And I'm like, all right, yeah.
Yeah.
But no, an incredibly unique experience you're mm-hmm. living, for sure.
And then also the catering that goes on around you is – or it's gone on around me of, now you have a strength and conditioning coach, you have a chef, you have daily scheduled activities, you have to go play basketball, you either have a game, you're in different hotels, you're on the road, you're missing valuable, delicate time, intentional time with family and friends that 9 months can be at a snap of a finger. And the reason why I ask you those things and I bring up these things is because I've tried my best to normalize my life in a society where I am the 0.03%. So it's difficult, but I do my best. So I'm doing my best. That's all I can do when I wake up is my best of, all right, I'm going to wake up and pray and meditate and give myself 15 minutes to an hour just with myself. Because as soon as I step out of this, I have responsibilities to not only myself, but I can go down the list of how many people I feel like I am responsible in their, you know, part of my responsibility in my life is impacting their lives.
Yeah.
And, you know, part of my purpose here too, and that's the most important thing for me, but part of my purpose is driving this change, driving this new paradigm shift of consciousness that's going on in communities that have been oppressed for long periods of time. You know what I mean? That have been either in traumatic experiences or they have historical complexities based on race, culture, class. I fall into that category in real life. Mm-hmm. Like, my family has dealt with ancestral trauma for centuries. So I am driven and purposefully driven to change that in my family because there are psychological effects that take precedent that are still going on. They're still dealing with things because of what they're seeing out in the world, and it's not changing. So, yes, I love the life and being part of the 0.03%, but I can never escape reality. So when I go home, this is what I'm in. I'm in reality. I base myself in reality, and to do that takes help. Takes mm-hmm. servitude. It takes stewardship. It takes faith. It takes a lot of these words that get thrown around as cliches, but for me, they have to have meaning. Otherwise, man, I'd be out here trying to live in an image of myself that, you know, to be honest with you, I tried to do that
at 22,
23, 24 and be something that everyone liked, or, you know, I was the most popular, or I got more money, or I got this. But now at 30, you know, for the last like 4 years, I've been through this transition, this ascension, as we'll call this enlightenment period, right? I'm not smarter than anybody else, but I've humbled myself to know, like, hey, I can't follow the same things that that came before me that don't help the community that I'm part of, you know?
I marvel at that with Kevin, as close as I am to him, and other people I've worked with before, and just celebrity in general.
I don't even like that word. You know what I mean? I don't even like celebrity. I don't even like famous or fame, or, you know, you're like, you're the example for your race, for your culture. Like, you can't throw that on one person, you know. Not, and I read this in a book. It's just like, one person cannot change the condition of all their people. It's not my responsibility. It's not one other person's responsibility to pick up, you know, kind of where the ancestors left off. You know, like, they definitely knew that there was something was up, and we could go into detail another one. They knew something was up in this world, and the way that, you know, people are treated based on race, culture, class. So I didn't mean to cut you off, but go ahead. Yeah,
but no, the word you keep using is the word I stick on, is responsibility. Mm-hmm. And like, almost every person you interact with, there is this responsibility to, like, they're expecting something out of you, whether it is to be that character they believe in, or whether it is there something like this. This is something that I've asked you to do, mm-hmm. and it's like, you did feel like, yo, I wanna do that for you. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? And it just feels like a ton of pressure to just constantly, every person, even the people you love and you want to do these things for, to just constantly juggle those things. Because it's basically every single person you come across. I watch you take pictures of people, and it's like, there's this idea of, Kyrie's this great guy, he's gonna take a picture for me. And then there's that weight on you, like, yo, I can't be that asshole that goes, no, sorry, little guys, yeah. I'm not taking no pictures with you. And yeah. I marvel at it, because it's a ton of weight to carry.
It is, and that's the part of it that I've stopped trying to make sense of it, because I didn't create it. You know what I mean? Yeah. I've just been conditioned since I was 16, 15 years old that this is the life that you're entering, and these are the rules that we're going to give you before you enter. But as soon as you get in here, I hope you know, there's going to be a lot more responsibility. 16 years old, you know, the kid at the Jewish Community Center or the Newark Community Center or outside, and they, you know, you just scored 30 points. Oh, you're the top 5 player in New Jersey. You better get used to it. People are going to ask you for pictures all the time. Mm-hmm. So they're like getting you ready for the life. And who is they, right? People are like, who are they? But it's just like, we know who they is if you really know. It's just like those who created the kind of like the what we're talking about discussing right now. It's, are you on all the time? Are you accessible for the world all the time? And I think some people in our world would prefer that you're on all the time. And that's like, it's inhumane to expect that out of somebody. Mm-hmm. So even if we compare it to on and off the court, my life off the court is enjoyable because I've had to fight for it. I've had to fight for my privacy. I've had to fight to earn trust from others and accept when I know that I'm not necessarily growing as a person while I'm trying to grow as a basketball player, you know. Mm-hmm. That can be a delicate balance that one has to figure out. But you know, my life off the court, bro, is like really about making conspiracy theories facts. As I look into the camera. No, but honestly, that was a joke. Okay, that was a joke. All
they're
right,
gonna, we can they're use not comedy. Posting this right? part.
We can use comedy. We can use satire. All right, that was a joke. Because you know I'm people, but
they're not posting that part.
No,
they're
no, no.
Wrong
with
what you
just
said.
Saying. Cool.
It's cool.
But my thing that I've used to approach life is like this humility and this hunger. I've had it since I was, you know, 15, 14 years old. Me and my dad really came up with this, so it just simplifies things. Like the humility to understand when you don't know things, to ask for help, to ask for guidance, to go to people when you need them, you know, and be there for people. Like really humbling yourself as a servant for our world. And then the hunger is just, you know, the hunger to fight for what's right, to stand on what you believe in. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to be hungry to do that. That takes courage, that takes bravery, you know, that takes really understanding who you are. And for all the youth out there that are watching this, you have to be a lot more patient with yourself, like hungry for patience. You know, you never probably heard that before, but it's just like really going out and finding yourself in uncomfortable places, but also knowing like those uncomfortable places don't have to be for you all the time. Mm-hmm. You can go be in comfortable spaces and still grow and do things with people that you love and enjoy time with. I'm in the public eye where I have to go into the den of whoever you want to call, but I, you know, my response to them is like, I was bred in a wolf den, you know? So I already know what it's like to be hungry for food. I already know what it's like to really put on for your family and want to get them out of the situation that they're in. You know, no one else has walked in my shoes in my family. No one. No one has made it to this type of level in society. You know, no one has made it to the point where they can understand everything I'm saying all the time. You know what I mean? Even though I don't expect to be understood, but like, it's just the reality, bro. So
this convo helps me understand how you and Kay are so close. Because I'm assuming, and you can tell me I'm wrong, but I'm assuming that there's a certain kinship and understanding that only a few of you guys can understand. I've talked with Kevin about this before, like the weight of being the best player. You know, I don't expect him and LeBron, him and Giannis, him and whoever else is in the combo to be best friends. But there's something that they all understand, and you fall in that as well. There's this running joke. Quarterbacks, there's never quarterbacks beef. There's 32 starting quarterbacks. They all shake hands after the game, and it's love because only they know what it's like to be the guy in town who throws the football for the football team. And so I would imagine, I would assume, there has to be a lot of the commonality for you and him where you guys got so tight.
Yeah, I'll compare it to this. The quarterback touched the ball first every time.
Yes.
It's the most
watched position. He's the center of the frame.
Center of the frame. There's people there to protect him. It's like that being it's like that being a quarterback in your family.
Yep.
There are decisions that you're going to understand, and there are going to be plays that you're going to have to run that are, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's broken down and I got to go.
They may be for you and they may be for others. And that's part of being a team, you know? But when you're the centralized focus, you take limited success, but then you take a bulk of the failure.
Yes.
So your success doesn't even, you know, sometimes success for me doesn't even feel like true success and enjoy and enjoyment, because I'm thinking about, like, how can I climb even higher? But when the failure hits, man, it feels like doomsday is going on 24/7. Like, people emotionalize that position as if they are in that.
Yeah.
Same, you know, they're the quarterback now. And it's so much easier for people to critique that role when you're the centralized focus. You can just, you know, like, hey, if you do this, if you do that. But as you said, there's only a few people that can truly understand how the mind and the body and the spirit works when you're in that position and all eyes on you, you know?
It's a ton of pressure. I mean, I think, you know, on a smaller scale, as visible as I've become and head of a household, it's like, yeah, this might be a 30s thing. Because I feel like in my 30s, I start climbing these mountains, and I'm like, yo, this is fire. And then I get to the mountain, and I'm like, there's another mountain right there.
Yeah.
And I know I can climb that one. And this one ain't even that cool now that I'm here. And so, yeah, you kind of – sometimes you got to appreciate the good in it. So.
Yeah, but that is a big
reason.
But
it's also what drives you to get to the next mountain.
Yes.
You wouldn't be Kyrie if you – could get to that mountain and be like, this is it. This is cool. This is all I wanted. I hit the game winner in game 7. I'm the coldest. I'm done.
Could have retired after 2016 and been like, you know what? This is the best that you guys are going to see. This is the best that you're going to get. But no, I went down to, you know, the bottom of the mountain and like, hey, let's do some more base camps. Let's go climb another one. And I tried it with different people. And that's always been, I think sometimes judging the wrong way is, you know, when I want to try new things, or sometimes I'll speak ahead of myself, it's literally out of curiosity. And I've learned to respect that and honor that trait within me, that curiosity is also what leads to some of the greatest mountaintops and also some of the biggest failures that happen in front of people, right? Yeah. Because you got to be comfortable with both. And that's another reason that me and Kay have become so close was, you know, we've succeeded and failed over and over again. And we've been seen as the leaders, and we've been seen as like great additions, and we've been seen as certain type of people in one type of community and different type of people in another. And we've had to battle that internally sometimes, where, you know, it leads to uncertainty.
Yeah.
You know, like questioning yourself, what am I doing here? And if you're questioning your purpose of life after a basketball game, or after someone talks shit, or after somebody says something that's like, oh, it, like, pinched a nerve, like, those are the points where I'm like, nah,
yeah,
I'm not doing that. I'm not questioning my purpose on this earth because I done lost a series to the Boston Celtics. Like, come on, bro. Like, enjoy it. You know what I mean?
I'm looking forward to the next mountaintop you guys climb. You want this sustained dominance. I love that that's your goal. I love, like, sustained team dominance. I can't wait till you guys, like, win 60 games and have, like, not an easy season, but, yo, I don't have to stress every night I go to Barclays. I can't wait for that. I have one last question, and I'm trying to – I know you have.
It don't have to be one last question. I gotta be out. What time is it?
It's 3:35.
Okay, cool. 3:45. I gotta be out.
Okay, so this is something I've been meaning to ask you since I've seen you. Are you? Should you have been NBA 75? There's the conspiracy theory that you were, and then weren't.
Yeah.
Should you be on that list?
Absolutely, absolutely, and. I don't even want to disrespect all those that are on it at all. Mm-hmm. Like, I really admire a lot of the talent that has come through our league, that has really set cornerstones and foundational, shall I say, pathways for people to follow, right? Or to achieve better, to want to achieve better. So I can't sit here and debate, you know, whether or not I was or I wasn't. I can only tell you how I feel. And absolutely, I feel like I deserve to be on that top 75 list, and simply because I'm part of the revolution of this game, and that's what drives me, as well as to continue to spark the next brain that's going to be part of the 0.03% of billions of people. So it's not going to be for everybody. You know, obviously the open conspiracy commentary is fun. To the banters back and forth is fun.
You don't have to, right? Comment on it. I won't walk.
No. I'm just saying.
I believe it.
Yeah. It's like it just goes back and forth. But I represent so much more than just the NBA top 75. So it was just one of those things. Like, okay, maybe the top 100. Maybe my name's on there, and we just keep moving. But I can tell my son a lot of these things that I've been through.
Yeah.
You know, I can share this with my daughter. In a perspective that helps her understand that you're not going to always receive things that you feel like you deserve. But when you're in a business, the gloves are off sometimes, bro. There's no right, wrong. You know what I mean? So I could sit here and debate all day, but I feel like I deserve to be on the top 75. And anybody that you put in front of me on that historical list, I'm feeling like if we go against each other, I'm getting the best out of them. And they're getting the best out of me. And that's what the game truly is about. It's bringing the best out of your competitor, your competition. That's what it's about. That's always what I've chased in this league, is playing against the best, being a hunter, being a target, you know what I mean, for others. And that's where I am. I'm 30 years old. I'm at the middle of my career. And the top 75 comes out. And I could have been like, oh, you know, F that. And been and like, and people asked me, and I was like, look, I'm used to this since I was in seventh grade, since I was called a weirdo and I sat by at the cafeteria by myself. Like, I don't mind it. You know what I mean? Because eventually along the way, guess who I'm going to find? My authentic community that really accepts me for my greatness. If that's not it, you know what I mean? And I'm in the top 100 in 25 years, whatever the case may be, great. But as of right now, let's just see where we end up in the next, you know, 5 to 10 years.
I don't want to pick any names out the hat, but yeah, I definitely saw some names and said, come on now. Come on. What are we doing here? But I think you're in the middle of your career. The way I kind of look at the sport is like, yo, if we do a book of the NBA, some guys are getting chapters, some guys are getting pages, sentences. You've got some pretty long paragraphs in that. You got something like, you might not be chapter word just yet, you know?
I'm fine with that.
But there's a lot to be said about you in this book, and definitely had you on my list.
No,
so.
I appreciate it. I appreciate it. Every single year, I don't try to make, like, controversial history, but I think over my last 5-year span, I've probably made like some, you know.
Yeah. I played a part in it. I apologize. I played a part in it last year, asking you about final shots and all that.
Shout out to LeBron. You know what I mean? He you know, he felt like I was slighting him, and I would never slight him in a way that, you know, would probably make him go and have to respond to things like that. You know what I mean? I respect the hell out of him. And,
yeah.
You know, we've been through our own battles as teammates, as competitors together. So, like, that's all part of it, bro. It's all fun, you know. But when you gotta go and communicate through alternative channels, that only makes things worse.
Yeah.
You feel me? You know what I mean? Like, that shit, that's like water under the bridge in terms of, you know, how people perceive what's being said, and then how I actually meant it. You know what I mean?
First, which made plenty of sense. Sitting there talking to you made plenty of sense. I get it. You pick it out. They do the same thing with the coaching thing. I get it. But this is like a 3-hour long convo we had.
and the only small excerpts, but that's what I've learned, is I can't necessarily hold on to the commentary that's being said about how I feel.
Mm-hmm.
I just got to honor how I feel and just make sure that I know I'm responsible for what I'm saying and just move forward, bro, because I've held on to a lot. Like, I'm not the person to go run to the camera or run to IG Live and be like, you know what? This is what really, really happened. And I'm just, that's not in my...
I appreciate your IG Lives, though. You've given me some good meme content. That's...
Bro, I'm happy about that, man.
I love that.
I just be telling people to be themselves, man. That's the essence of it.
So what I tell people privately when they ask me about you, and like we finally flicked it up, but it's like I tell people all the time, the Kyrie we see in public, that's also who I see in private, and I really, really respect that. No matter whether or not I agree with every single thing you say, mm-hmm. I generally do. Like, not just because you're here. We have some similar viewpoints. Mm-hmm. But, like, Sage, people look... My grandma had me at powwows when I was a kid. She smudged every house. I was in my nanny. Rest in peace.
Mm-hmm. Peace.
So, it warmed my heart to see you on your birthday and you smudged the place we were at. I'm like, I love this. I go to the Hurricane and I pop up. And my guy at the register gives me a nice little bit of sage on the way out. So, like, people make these big deals at us, but I can genuinely say, I've said it in private, like, yeah, the guy we see unapologetically is also the guy that I've seen behind closed doors. And I really appreciate that about you.
Thank you, brother.
I'm excited to see the next step. I'm excited to see you this summer. Show up, watch the work. I want to show my son with how hard Kyrie works.
You're doing.
I appreciate you for doing this, man. I know it's been a long time coming, and
I'm glad I'm the first guest back.
What do you mean? Like, you can be here whenever you want.
Clean up hitter, man. Clean up hitter from our first time going about. So I was just,
I hope we don't get you in trouble this time, but I don't think we did.
Nah, it's not about trouble, bro.
It's always great talking to you, though. Thanks, brother. I appreciate that, and appreciate you doing this.
Yes, sir.